Welcome to Schools Not Out, your daily classroom for C-Second Cape students. You can watch this lesson real-time on Television Jamaica's YouTube channel or One Spot Media. We are also live on Music99 and GoJamaica.com. If you have questions on today's subject, you can send them into Television Jamaica's Facebook page or Instagram at Television_Jamaica. Today's lesson is on Cape Physics Unit 1, where we will be focusing on simple harmonic motion. I am Paul Bender. Good morning. Welcome back to Schools Not Out. Today's topic is simple harmonic motion. And, you know, simple harmonic motion has to do with oscillations, things that move from one point to another in a continuous fashion. And we will see that simple harmonic motion is a special type of oscillatory motion. But if we look around us, there are so many things that we see oscillations, and it is important to study these oscillations. Things like pendulum clocks, or in your car suspension, in the car engine with the pistons, they move up and down, and so many other things that oscillatory motion is important. So let's see what the lesson is about today. At the end of today's lesson, you should be able to state the conditions for an oscillating mass to move with simple harmonic motion. Relate simple harmonic motion to circular motion. Write equations for the displacement, velocity, and acceleration of a simple harmonic oscillator, and interpret displacement time, velocity time, acceleration time, and acceleration displacement graphs for a simple harmonic oscillator. There are some things that you should know, and you should already know from your lessons in circular motion that angular velocity is equal to angular displacement represented by theta divided by time, and angular velocity is equal to 2 pi divided by t, where t is the period of the rotational motion. These you would have learned in circular motion. All right, so let's look and see. Here we have a mass that is oscillating between two fixed positions. And from here on, we will call this oscillating mass. We will call it an oscillator. And if this mass is oscillating such that its direction is directed towards the equilibrium position, this is the position at which it started, and if the acceleration is proportional to its displacement from the equilibrium position, it is oscillating with what you call simple harmonic motion. Now, when this mass moves this way, in order for it to move back this way, there must be some force acting on it. And we know that from Newton's first law. If it is to change direction, then there must be a force that is causing it to change direction. And if there is a force acting on the mass, then the mass will have an acceleration, okay? And also, so we will look and see what our conditions for this force could be placed on this mass to cause it to change direction continuously. And we call that force a restoring force, a force that brings back the mass towards the equilibrium position, brings it back towards the equilibrium position. And that force acting on a mass will give that mass an acceleration. And so we see the acceleration is directed this way, acceleration that way, acceleration this way, acceleration that way. All right, it's always directed towards the equilibrium position. And we will look at the proportionality with the displacement. So here we have a snapshot of this is one way in which this mass can be made to oscillate between these two fixed positions. If it's attached to a spring, the spring will supply the forces necessary to keep the mass moving between these two positions here. All right. So, for instance, when the mass When the mass has been displaced by this amount here, the mass was originally here displaced, the spring is stretched, and when the spring is stretched, it will pull back the mass with some force towards the equilibrium position. Then the mass is now a little further back. Because the string is stretched by a larger amount, the force that it is pulling with is a larger force, and the extension, the displacement of the mass is larger. So here we see larger displacement, larger force, and what we're seeing is that if they are proportional, then the mass is oscillating with simple harmonic motion. Then we look on the other side. When the mass has been displaced by this amount, the spring is compressed a little bit. It's compressed, so the spring is pushing the mass back that way. So the force is acting again towards equilibrium position. Small displacement, smaller force. And if we go right back where the mass has come to extend, you see that the spring is really compressed and the displacement is large, and so the force is larger. Larger displacement, larger force. And what we notice is that the displacement and the force are always, excuse me, in opposite directions. All right. So we have put the mass back in the middle. And so we notice here that the mass doesn't have any force because at this point, at this position, the spring is neither stretched nor is it compressed. Okay. So let's have a little quick quiz. A quick quiz. We're having a few issues here. All right. The question asks, what is the magnitude of the acceleration of a simple harmonic oscillator, that's the moving mass, when it is passing through its equilibrium position? That's the first question. And if the oscillator was a moving target, at which point would you aim so that you would have the best chance of hitting it? So this oscillator is moving like this. And imagine you're in a game room and you have your thing and you're going to fire at it. Which position you're going to fire at so that you stand the best chance of hitting it. And the first one, what is the magnitude of the acceleration? So let's see what, if we click for the answer. All right, the acceleration is zero. Because you remember, we said that at the zero position, in the equilibrium position, the spring is neither stretched nor compressed, so that it exerts no force on the mass. If there is no force, there is no acceleration. And if it was a moving target, where the displacement is maximum, because remember the mass goes to the extremity, stops momentarily, then comes back, stops momentarily. So when it is at rest, that is the best time to pick it off. So aim at the corner, so as soon as it comes to rest, you will be able to pick it off. All right, so that will be the best position. Okay. So I'll have a little demonstration here that I'm going to do. Here I have a small device. This is, I am able to spin this contraption here, and on it there is a screw with a bead on it, and we will see what we will do with that. But this arrow, we call it a phaser. And so as I rotate this, you see that the red line is also rotating. But what I'm going to do, I want you to focus on the shadow. You see the shadow of the bead is on the board here, right? And I will rotate the disc. Now, as I rotate the disc, I want you to look at what is happening with the shadow. The bead is going right along in a circular path, but what is happening with the shadow? I'll try to keep it steady. The shadow is going up and down and up and down. So the shadow is performing oscillatory motion the projection of the thing is performing oscillatory motion, but the actual thing is moving in a circular path. And so that what we're seeing is that oscillatory motion is a projection of circular motion. If we project an object that is moving on a circular path onto a surface, that object will be moving with oscillatory motion. So let me just show you again. Here we go a little faster. All right, we see that the shadow is going up and down when actually on this, it is moving around. And that is key to understanding how we analyze circular motion. I'm sorry, oscillatory motion. So that's a demonstration. So here we go. Here we go. Here we have this phasor going around anti-clockwise. And remember, this now is the shadow moving up and down. This is the shadow moving up and down. And what we're doing is plotting a graph against of the angular displacement of this phasor against the displacement, the linear displacement of the dot, right? And when you do that for each time, you see you get a sinusoidal curve. And so we have, this is our phasor moving around. This is the shadow, and this is the graph that is plotted. All right, so we're relating circular motion to oscillatory motion to a graphical representation. So we're moving from stage to stage. Okay. Now, so here we are. Suppose this is just an instant in time. This is a snapshot. You take a snapshot of what is happening. And so at this instant, the angular displacement of the phasor is theta, all right? We have the linear displacement of the shadow is x. And the maximum displacement of the shadow would be a, because when this phasor meets to the top here, the shadow gets up here and then it comes back down. So this is the maximum displacement, and we call it a, all right? But if we bring all of those together now, we get a triangle, right? A, x, and theta. And if we look here now, and we look at this triangle, sine of the angle theta is the side opposite over the hypotenuse, that's x over a. And so x is equal to a times sine theta. But we know from our circular motion, this is our prerequisite knowledge, but theta is equal to omega t, because we know that angular velocity is equal to angular displacement divided by time. So that angular displacement is omega times t, so that we can substitute for omega times t here. And this is a very important result. It's kind of low. This is a very important result. We have that the displacement x is equal to maximum displacement sine of the angular, we call it angular frequency times t. And this is just a simple way on how we arrive at this equation here. And this is an important equation for simple harmonic motion. All right. So in the equation A sine omega t for the displacement of a harmonic oscillator, A is the maximum displacement, as I showed already. Omega is called the angular frequency of the oscillation. So omega, we call it angular frequency. In circular motion, we call it angular velocity. It is numerical equal to the angular velocity of the phasor, that line that is going around. From previous knowledge, omega is 2 pi over t, where t is the period of rotation of the phasor. So those are some key points that you need, and key terms that you need to internalize as well. Okay, this part I have put three equations. Some of you may not have been exposed to calculus, all right? And so the CAPE syllabus requires that you know these equations here and be able to use them. So if you do know calculus, we know that velocity is rate of change of displacement, dx dt, and when you differentiate a sine omega t, you will get a omega a cos omega t. If you don't know calculus, or you haven't done calculus, then you probably just have to commit it to memory. And acceleration is rate of change of velocity, which is dv dt. And when we differentiate this here, omega a cos omega t, we will get omega negative omega squared a sine omega t. But a sine omega t is x, so a would be negative omega squared x. So acceleration, and we see a relationship now between velocity, acceleration, and displacement. And we can represent these graphically. All right, we will look at them graphically. So we have three graphs. So this represents this graph, a sine omega t. This is for the displacement. And we see the maximum displacement on the graph is a. Okay? V is a cos omega t. Cos and sine are 90 degrees out of phase. And since this is omega a, its magnitude is a little greater than a. It could be smaller. So here we see this is a cos curve, and that would be for V. And then we see that A is negative omega squared A sine omega T. So this would be negative omega squared A. And what it's saying is that these two are 180 degrees out of phase. You remember when we looked at the oscillating system, when the force was acting towards the equilibrium position, the displacement was in the opposite direction. So they are vectors in opposite directions. So one is negative with respect to the other one. And that is what that sign is showing, that these here are 180 degrees out of phase. Okay? So these are our three representations of the displacement, the velocity, and the acceleration of that same simple harmonic oscillator as it moves. This is how these three parameters or these three physical quantities associated with this oscillating system, that is how they change. All right. So we'll have a quick quiz again. Yeah. All right. The following information relates to a simple harmonic oscillator. The maximum displacement is 0.5 meters. The maximum velocity is 2 meters per second. Determine the magnitude of the maximum acceleration of the oscillator. All right? Okay. So here, let's see what if we click for our answer. I know I'm kind of rushing, but it's just I would have given you some more time. But the maximum, remember, if we go back to our graphs, that the maximum velocity is angular frequency times this maximum displacement. And so the angular frequency would be equal to the maximum, the velocity divided by the maximum amplitude or the maximum displacement, which is 20, and that will give you 4 radians per second. And A is omega squared A, that would be 4 squared times 0.5, and that will give you 8 meters per second squared. Okay, you can take some time out to take a more in-depth look at that. Oh, my God, I gotta go back. So let me head back here. Come on, man. All right. So now we will look at some graphs of a simple harmonic oscillator. All right. So we looked at displacement time, velocity time, and acceleration time graphs. Now here we are going to look at acceleration against displacement graph. All right, now if we plot a graph of the acceleration of the harmonic oscillator against its displacement, this is what the graph will look like. And this is consistent with what we see, all right? Because you remember, we said that acceleration is equal to negative omega squared x. And this is a graph with a negative gradient, all right? So that graph would have a negative gradient. And so this represents a graph with a negative gradient, right? So that's consistent with what we're seeing, all right? And so we, again, as usual, we'll have a quick quiz. All right, what is the gradient of the acceleration displacement graph for a simple harmonic oscillator represent? What does it represent? What quantity does it represent? We know that for a velocity time graph, the gradient represents acceleration, and for a displacement time graph, it represents velocity. But that is for linear motion. What about harmonic motion? Which one of these does it represent? Does the displacement time graph represent velocity, angular frequency, or the negative of the square of the angular frequency? All right, and so let's see what the result would be. If we click. All right, so what we see is that it will be the negative of the square of the angular frequency. And the explanation is that since A is equal to negative omega squared x, a graph of x A against x would give you a straight line with a gradient of negative omega squared. All right? So so that will be the result there. Here we have graphs of a simple harmonic oscillator. Again, this graph shows the variation of the velocity of a simple harmonic oscillator with its displacement. All right, so this also is consistent. What we see is when the displacement is maximum, the velocity is zero. So velocity is zero anywhere on this axis. So displacement is maximum, velocity is zero. Displacement is maximum on the other side, velocity is zero. And when we see that the displacement is zero, the velocity is maximum. And here we can come back and relate to our target, our moving target. When the target is passing through the equilibrium position, it has its maximum velocity, it is moving fastest, and it will be the hardest to hit. But when it comes to the end here, it stops and then goes back the other way. So it will be much easier to hit. So the velocity is maximum. So here we can say, at the equilibrium position, the acceleration is zero. We saw that because there is zero force. And the velocity is maximum. At the maximum displacement, the velocity is zero and the acceleration is maximum. Because remember when we looked at the spring, we saw that the spring was stretched to a maximum, and so that would be exerting the greatest force, and that would cause a greatest acceleration. So let's have a quick quiz. All right. Use the information on the velocity versus displacement graph below to determine the period of oscillation of the simple harmonic oscillator. Here we see the maximum velocity is 20 meters per second, and the maximum displacement is 5 meters. Okay? All right. So let's see. Let's click for our answer. All right. We know that V max is equal to omega A, and omega is 2 pi over T, which you would have learned from already. That's the previous knowledge. So if we substitute 2 pi over T for omega, you will get V max is 2 pi A over T. All right? And rearrange the equation, you will get for the period, you will get 2 pi A over V max. All right? Make the substitution 2 times pi times A is 5 meters divided by V max, which is 20 meters per second. And when you work that out, you'll get T, the period, is 1.5 7 seconds. All right, so this is information that you're using on the graph to be able to work out other parameters. And you can determine the frequency as well, because frequency is 1/period. Okay, you can determine a number of parameters. Okay, if you know the mass of the harmonic oscillator, you can determine what is the restoring force, all right, from the oscillator, based on the information that you've garnered from the graph. All right, we have not, our time constraints does not allow, but these are things that you can look at. Okay, so we are here. This is a challenge question. The challenge question is asking, show that the velocity of a simple harmonic oscillator at any displacement x can be found from this equation. V squared equal omega squared a squared times a squared minus x squared. And so what I will do, I will recap some what it is we have done so far. All right, I want to go back to a few slides here. This one. Okay. What we see here, all right, is that, and it shows, and this is an important result here. So we have our harmonic oscillator that is oscillating between two fixed positions. So it is here and it is here. All right. This is the equilibrium position. This is the maximum displacement on this side, and this is the maximum displacement on this side. At the equilibrium position, displacement is equal to zero, all right? And the velocity is maximum. And the acceleration is equal to zero. That's at the equilibrium position. As this thing passes through the equilibrium position, here, x is the maximum. But at this position, velocity is equal to zero, and acceleration is maximum. All right? Because remember now, if this were a spring attached to somewhere, the spring would be stretched to its maximum. Right? The spring would be stretched to its maximum when it is at this position here. All right? And so this is also key. Right, at these positions, and the graph shows you it. At when the displacement is zero, we see that the velocity is maximum and the acceleration is zero. When the displacement is maximum, we see the velocity is zero and the acceleration is also maximum. So the graphs also bear out this relationship here. And so all of these things are tied in. And so it is very important to understand that that oscillatory motion, this object moving between two fixed positions, is related to circular motion. And we can think of oscillatory motion as a projection of circular motion, and that projection can be used to make graphical representations of what the oscillatory motion is. Okay, so these are some key points that you want to internalize so that you'll be able to make better judgments on what it is. More Schools Not Out continues after this break. Stay with us.
reduce your risk of viral illnesses like the flu and coronavirus. Wash your hands frequently with soap and water. Cover your nose and mouth when coughing with a tissue and dispose of it. Avoid close contact with anyone with a cold or flu-like symptoms. If you become ill, please visit your doctor or the nearest health center and share your travel history. The flu and coronavirus can kill. Let's protect each other. A message from the Ministry of Health and Wellness.
COVID-19 tip. Protect yourself and others from getting sick by washing your hands after coughing or sneezing, when caring for the sick, before, during, and after you prepare food, before eating, after toilet use, when hands are visibly dirty, and after handling animals or animal waste.
The Ministry of Education, Youth and Information, along with TVJ, present Schools Not Out, CSEC and CAPE lessons live Mondays to Fridays from 9 a.m. to 12 noon, with weekly Schools Not Out tutorial sessions on Saturdays from 1 p.m. to 4 p.m. Schools Not Out, live CSEC and CAPE lessons here on TVJ.
Reduce your risk of viral illnesses like the flu and coronavirus. Wash your hands frequently with soap and water. Cover your nose and mouth when coughing with a tissue and dispose of it. Avoid close contact with anyone with a cold or flu-like symptoms. If you become ill, please visit your doctor or the nearest health center and share your travel history. The flu and coronavirus can kill. Let's protect each other. A message from the Ministry of Health and Wellness.
COVID-19 tip. Protect yourself and others from getting sick by washing your hands after coughing or sneezing, when caring for the sick, before, during, and after you prepare food, before eating, after toilet use, when hands are visibly dirty, and after handling animals or animal waste.
The Ministry of Education, Youth and Information, along with TVJ, present Schools Not Out, CSEC and CAPE lessons live Mondays to Fridays from 9 a.m. to 12 noon, with weekly Schools Not Out tutorial sessions on Saturdays from 1 p.m. to 4 p.m. Schools Not Out, live CSEC and CAPE lessons here on TVJ.
Risk of viral illnesses like the flu and coronavirus. Wash your hands frequently with soap and water. Cover your nose and
welcome back to Schools Not Out, where we are discussing CAPE Physics Unit 1, and the topic is simple harmonic motion. When we left off, I had left you with a challenge question. And I hope that you would have gotten an opportunity to at least try the question to see if you how much progress you've been able to make. Also, I was hopeful that some of you would have sent in some questions with regard to the topic that just went, because that helps not only you to clear up any doubts or anything that you might have, but also there may be other persons who want to ask the very question that you want to ask. And so it is always a very good thing, and you will get an opportunity to see how much you understand when you ask questions. But let us take a look at this question here and see if we can work through to get a solution to it. Again, if you may not be familiar, but for those of you who would have done some calculus, and you would know that sine squared A plus cos squared A is equal to 1. Right? This is called a trigonometric identity. And some of these become very important when we go on to do higher level physics, as in CAEP. All right, but let's see if we can solve this equation. We know that x is equal to a sine omega t, all right? And we know that v is equal to omega a cos omega t. So if we square v, we will get that v squared is equal to omega squared a cos squared omega t. That's okay? All right, we just square v. Let's call this, divide my board. All right, but remember now, here, from the trigonometric identity, cos squared omega t is equal to, if I'm cos squared a is 1 minus sine squared a, so that will be 1 minus sine squared omega t. So that is what cos squared omega t is equal to. All right. So here, therefore, we can write that v squared is equal to omega squared a times 1 minus sine squared omega t. Okay? So that's because we substitute the 1 minus sine squared omega t for cos squared omega t in this equation here. Alright? So, if we expand expand the brackets, we will get that v squared is equal to omega squared a minus omega squared a sine squared omega t. Okay? So we just expanded the brackets. Okay. So this would be equal to omega squared times a minus a squared. This is omega squared. I'm sorry. When I square here, this is omega squared a squared, omega squared a squared. So let me go back through. When I square v, you have to square the omega, you have to square the a, and you have to square the trigonometric function. So this would be omega squared a squared. All right, my apologies for that. And this would be omega squared a squared, sine squared omega t. But this here, a squared sine squared omega t is equal to x squared. But a squared sine squared omega t is equal to x squared. So therefore, v squared is equal to a squared minus x squared. I'm sorry. Wow. Omega squared times a squared minus x squared. All right? And so that's how we would come up with this is what we were looking for. It involved one, it was a challenge because it involved you finding out about this trigonometric identity. And that's what challenges are about. You could ask your friend who did, or your cousin, your anybody who would have done. And this is something, one of the fundamental trigonometric identities that you will have to learn. Okay? And so this is just the derivation. And so we can write that the velocity, we have this equation for the velocity, but we can also write that velocity is equal to omega times the square root of a squared minus x squared. All right? So that's that there. All right, so I'll try to just make a question. You can still ask questions. You can still send in the questions so we can have any kind of discussion that we can have with regards to the question that you have. All right? So I will put some figures. I will put some figures to these things. So let us see. All right. So if we have a simple harmonic oscillator moving with a velocity, the velocity is, say, V is 5 meters per second. That's the velocity of the simple harmonic oscillator. The maximum A is, say, A is 0.08 meters. All right, so A is that. And X, we want to find what, and T, the period of the oscillation, is 0.4 seconds. All right? We want to find what is the displacement when the velocity is the value given. So we want to find what X is when V is 5 meters per second. Remember, the velocity of the oscillating body is not constant. It varies. So at some point it is zero, that is at the maximum. At some point it's a maximum. So this question is asking us, if we know this here, that the maximum displacement is 0.08 meters and the period is 0.4 seconds, you want to find what is the displacement when V is 5 meters per second. So we can employ what we have in this equation here, and we can see what we have. All right, so we'll have that V squared is equal to omega squared A squared minus X squared. Now remember, now omega is 2 pi over T. All right? Omega is equal to 2 pi over T, and that will be 2 pi over 0.4. And I will leave you to do the mathematics. I will just show you. And then so you will have that V squared is equal to omega squared, which is 2 pi over 0.4 squared, times A squared, which is 0.08 squared minus 0.4 x squared. And we know that we want to find, and we know that V is 5 meters per second. So 5 squared, and we can work through that. So 5 squared equal to 2 pi over 0.4 squared times 0.08 squared minus X squared. All right? And from here, you'd be able to determine what the value for X is in this given situation. It's not always quite a good thing to do, but I just had gotten these numbers, and so I'm very hopeful when you go to work it out that you don't get this square root of a negative number. I doubt whether do. All right? Yeah, it'll be kind of small. So this is how you can utilize these equations in order to be able to make calculations. I hope that today's lesson was instructive, because this is a very important aspect of the physics here. So physics, we hope you grasp some of the points we've discussed. You can catch a repeat of today's lesson on JNN today at 4 p.m. in the School's Not Out highlights on Saturday between 1 and 4 p.m. right here on TVJ. It also will be on video on demand on One Spot Media. Until next time, I am Paul Bender. Up next, EDPM. Stay with us. Safe.